and he rules and reigns over the entirety of humanity, knowing how short we all fall and making straight our path straight back to him. And for those that struggle to trust God, you know, recognize he's given us more than enough evidence to trust him. How he sustains creation. We know that beautiful mountain settings don't just make themselves. You know, the sun doesn't continue to burn throughout human history by itself. You know, the reason we even get to think about God is because he's made us at our very core with eternity in heart. We're made with individual fingerprints and iris scans and stuff like that. We're made with brains to use for his glory. He gives us science so that we can marvel at the depth of his design scientifically. He gives us the biggest selling book in all history, the Holy Bible, so that we can see the evidence of him historically. The eyewitness accounts of over 500 plus eyewitnesses that saw him publicly living and risen after being publicly murdered, so we can see the evidence testimonially. We've recovered facets that can be tested to the exact time the Bible claims, so we can trust the evidence archaeologically. He's given us over 300 particular and precise prophecies about Jesus that he would come and fulfill, so that we can trust the evidence prophetically. God has given us so much, yet some people still fail to trust him. 1 Timothy 1:15 says this: "Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst." See, Jesus didn't come into the world to condemn the world and make us all feel bad. He came to save it. He knew every element of our existence, every urge and action, every idea, every impulse, every intention. He knows every one of our wrongdoings and still chooses to love us. But being a God of justice, he couldn't just close his eyes and pretend that the free will he gave us that we chose to use to actively sin against him and his creation every day was somehow just okay. No, he had to deal with it justly, and our sin warrants the death penalty. And the Bible says that the wages of sin, what we earn for our sin at the end of our life, is death. That's why at the end of our life, this side of eternity, we physically die. It's like when we drive past a speed camera too quick and we get a penalty, but we don't get it straight away. It comes in the post a little while later. And Jesus knew that the penalty for our sin was death. But longing to restore that broken relationship between Creator and created, he chose to pay that penalty for us. See, Jesus did not bark instructions from the sky. He came down to earth as a helpless child. He did not send an army of angels to eradicate every person who does wrong. He sent himself to help those that do. Jesus did not force us to love him like controlling robots, but he gave us free will to choose to call on him for mercy. Jesus went through pain and suffering to help us through pain and suffering, and he ultimately chose death to help us through death. And as we now know, death is beaten, it's lost its sting. Jesus has overcome the grave, and so will all those who choose to call on his name in doing the same. So if you're watching this and you've not yet called out to Jesus to be the Lord of your life, to save you from your sin, may I encourage you to pray this prayer in your heart as well. Lord Jesus, I don't understand it all, but I know I've done things against you and your creation. I've thought wrong things, said wrong things, and done wrong things, and I'm sorry, Lord. Please forgive me of all my wrongdoings. Forgive me of my sin. Come and be the Lord of my life. Help me to repent and turn away from these things, Lord, so that I may have a life that is right in your sight. Help me, Lord. Speak to me, Lord. Guide me. Come and have your way in my heart. I ask you in Jesus' name. Amen.